Tourism Secretary Cristina Frasco reportedly going on leave amid the controversy surrounding the Love the Philippines campaign. See, reports say Frasco will go on vacation with her family beginning this week. Frasco has been under pressure to dump the new tourism slogan after the ad agency that created a promotional video for the campaign admitted to using stock footage of other countries. The tourism department, however, seems bent on keeping the Love the Philippines slogan, which was seen in recent DOT events. The 40 peso wage increase in Metro Manila will press ahead despite an appeal from labor groups. That's according to the Labor Department. Last month, the wage board approved a 40 peso minimum wage hike, which will take effect on July 16. Several labor organizations found the increase insufficient, citing high inflation. The groups say the wage hike should be based on the family living wage and not the poverty threshold. A group of companies from the United States reaffirmed their commitment to boost cooperation and investment in the Philippines. Members of the Business Executives for National Security met with President Marcos Monday. On the agenda, business opportunities in health, digital infrastructure, and energy. Marcos said the country will soon launch a multi-specialty hospital outside Manila in order to bring health care down to the grassroots level. The president also assured the group his administration will address the concerns of the American executives regarding the price, reliability, and supply of energy, as well as the ease of doing business in the country. The Philippines' trade deficit narrowed further in May to $4.4 billion. This as exports grew for the first time in 6 months, while imports fell. Total export sales hit $6.4 billion, a nearly 2% increase from a year ago, on the back of higher shipment in electronic products. Imports, meanwhile, fell 8.8% to $10.8 billion, dragged by lower shipments in mineral fuels, lubricants, and related materials. According to the Philippine Statistics Authority, China was the country's biggest supplier of imported goods as well as the country's top export trading partner in May. A tech expert sees much potential for the Philippines to take the lead in terms of using artificial intelligence. Earl Martin Valencia of the National Innovation Council, or NIC, says the country should take advantage of its demographic window, with majority of the population being young and tech-savvy. He adds the Philippines could even become a first-world country in 25 years through proper innovation plans.
The innovation agenda goes from R&D or ideation all the way up to commercialization, right? The theory really here is how do we actually make the entrepreneur or the commercialization piece the centerpiece of the innovation agenda of the Philippines. So how do we build up a whole ecosystem, including the tools, the education, the private sector help, the public sector help, to actually fuel the what they call as the corporate entrepreneur or the external entrepreneur to actually create these new technologies that make sense for the Philippines. Why do you want to invest, right? There's only two reasons, either to grow profit or to save cost, right? So that's the beauty about, you know, these types of new technologies, right? For example, artificial intelligence. These are things that will literally streamline your operations because they can scale beyond the human being.
President Marcos, who chairs the NIC, recently greenlit the National Innovation Agenda and Strategy document. It aims to improve the country's governance by the use of new technology. Indian companies in the electrical and engineering sectors are holding a meeting for partnership opportunities here in the Philippines. Our correspondent, Lady Vicencio, now joins us with an update. Lady, over to you.
Carmina, delegates of Indian companies are looking into possible business opportunities in the country, specifically in the energy and construction sector. The Embassy of India and the Indian Electrical and Electronics Manufacturers organized a 4-day event with the Philippine Overseas Construction Board. An Indian ambassador to the Philippines, Shambhu Kumaran, emphasized on the potential of India-Philippines partnership as both countries are putting up a heavy focus on infrastructure development. Kumaran said he expects more investments between the two countries by becoming reliable suppliers, specifically in the construction and energy sector. The Construction Industry Authority of the Philippines highlighted a successful 2022 bilateral trade between the Philippines and India, raking in $3 billion. CIAP Executive Director, Attorney Marco Maat, is confident that partnerships will contribute to the success of the country's infrastructure programs and that the Philippines could also be a leading global partner in outsourcing services in the construction and engineering services sector. Government projects open for bidding and partnerships were presented in the event, including operations and maintenance concessions for the Metro Manila Subway Project, North-South Commuter Railway, and the MRT Lines 4 and 3. The Department of Energy also presented opportunities in the energy sector as it aims for a 35% renewable energy generation by 2030, or a total of 50 gigawatt capacity. India, on the other hand, is aiming for net zero by 2070 and expects its energy requirement to go up by more than 2 times, opening more opportunities from Philippine companies and for investments and partnerships, according to the IMA. The afternoon sessions here are expected to be productive as delegates will be given time for B2B meetings for business opportunities in the two countries.
The ASEAN Plus 3 region is expected to grow by 4.6% this year. Let's get more on this from our correspondent, Jackie Pascual. He now joins us on the line. Jackie, go ahead.
Hi, good afternoon, Carmina. ASEAN Plus 3 Macroeconomic Research Office, or AMRO, reports the economies in the ASEAN Plus 3 region is expected to grow by 4.6% this year as domestic demand beefs up the economy in many Asian countries. This is better than the 3.2% gross domestic product growth last year. ASEAN Plus 3 includes Southeast Asia, China, Korea, and Japan. Without the Plus 3, ASEAN is expected to grow by 4.5%, which is slightly lower than the April estimate of 4.9% due to weakening global trade. The AMRO chief economist said that the Philippines will also be among the fastest growing economies in the region, with a GDP forecast of 6.2% for this year and 6.5% for next year. This is, however, lower than the country's 2022 GDP of 7.6%. He cited the Philippines' economy as more service-driven than manufacturing-based, which is why the country is expected to expand further because of the boom in the services sector post-pandemic. He mentioned that the Philippines did very well in terms of sustaining its growth, partly because of the structured economy of the country, which is quite different from other ASEAN economies. Inflation is also expected to go down across ASEAN Plus 3, which recorded inflation at 6.5% last year. This year, it is projected to settle at 6.3% and 3.4% by next year. The high inflation in Laos and Myanmar is pulling inflation rate up in the region, which are projected to reach 25.7%. and 26% inflation rate, respectively. The Philippine inflation is, meanwhile, will go down in the coming months, forecast at 5.9% for this year and 3.8% for next year. Carmina, though the picture is positive, AMRO also said there are potential shocks, like the possible recession in the U.S. and Euro, weaker than expected growth in China, and a risk of a financial spillover from the U.S. because of its tight monetary policy rate. On the other hand, AMRO is seeing a turnaround in consumer spending, strong domestic economy in Asia, and a growing tourism sector.
The timetable for the opening of Metro Manila's first subway pushed back by 2 years to year 2029. Jackie Manabat gives us a look at the subway tunnel's construction.
Billed as the project of the century, the construction of the Metro Manila Subway Project is on track as the Department of Transportation aims to open the first subway in the country by 2029. However, the agency scrapped its initial plan to operate the subway partially in 2027. Instead, the Department of Transportation will open the subway with all its 17 stations in 2029 or 6 years from now.
We are not looking into the partial operability of 2027. Ang target na natin is full operations by 2029. Kasi kung magpa-partial operability tayo hanggang a certain station, hindi naman natin siya, parang hindi siya optimized, no, for our passengers, di ba? So it would be best na we just operate it pagka buo na.
The officials invited the press for a tour of the construction of the Valenzuela Depot Monday morning. They said that the 33-kilometer underground railway is 33% complete when it comes to civil works. They have yet to address the right-of-way issues, mostly in Valenzuela City. Once opened in 2029, it is expected to accommodate an estimate of 519,000 passengers daily from Valenzuela Station to NAIA Terminal 3 and FTI in Taguig. The subway will also be interconnected with other rail lines, such as the future North-South Commuter Railway Station in Taguig. The proposed fare for the subway is 22 pesos for the boarding fee and a distance fare of 2 pesos per kilometer, which means that the end-to-end fare will be 88 pesos. However, the DOTR said this is not yet the final fare, as they have added 4 more stations and they have yet to consider the slowdown of construction brought about by the impact of the pandemic. Originally estimated to cost 350 billion, the project's total cost was raised to 488 billion pesos. The joint venture, including Shimizu Corporation, Fujita Corporation, and Takenaka Civil Engineering of Japan, and EEI Corporation from the Philippines, were tapped to design and build the depot in Valenzuela City, Quezon Highway Station, Tandansora Station, and North Avenue Station. The Metro Manila subway will leverage Japanese technology to make the structure flood and earthquake-proof.
Our Japan design team designed the subway similar to Japan. It is elevated. There is even a simulation exercise where water cannot pass through from outside. Kasi meron siyang, remember yung entry natin siya ay maliit lang. Tapos meron siyang gate doon. Sarado yun. Airtight yung gate doon. Kapag ka may tubig, kapag mabaha. Pero hindi tayo babahain sapagkat elevated ang gate natin.
From Valenzuela, the excavation will run for a kilometer and a half to reach the next station, Quirino Station in Novaliches. The tunnel boring machine, also manufactured in Japan, will lay down 8 to 10 meters of tunnel segments per day, excavating around 300 to 400 meters of soil in the same time frame. The subway station is expected to ease traffic congestion in Metro Manila. Jackie Manabat, ABS-CBN News.